How many of y'all got touched this morning? Well, it's going to continue. Yes. Woohoo! Turn to your neighbor and tell them, this is your day to die to yourself. Ooh, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it because we have a choice to rejoice. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, praise God. How many of y'all know we're in the last days? We're in the last minutes, let me tell you. Things are happening very, very rapidly. You know, one of the things that the enemy tries to do is not only discourage, but his greatest weapon is deception. Remember that the earth is ruled by deception. Amen? And in this area of deception, there's three kingdoms. And then we've talked about this before. There's what you see around you is called the kingdom of self. Amen? It's tangible. What it does is promote self. Self loves this realm. Then there's the kingdom of Satan that influences this kingdom and those who are walking in self. And his purpose is to influence us, to keep us deceived so he can manipulate us and use us and use us as a welcome mat for his kingdom. Then there's the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is what allows me and you to overcome the kingdom of self and the kingdom of Satan's influence. So in this, there's this place where Jesus said, he gave us a formula. If you really want to be my disciple, if you really want to follow me, if you really love me, you'll deny yourself. Why? Because denying yourself is the only way out of the kingdom of self. That's the only way out. Other than that, you still stay in the kingdom of self. You become religious. You may do the things of God, but not really know him. It's long distance. And one thing he's not looking for is a long distance relationship. He's looking for a personal relationship. One of the greatest things that you and I can be is his son and daughter. He's not looking for people to serve him. He's looking for people to know him. But again, one of the things we have been brought up with is in religion. I was at some mechanic shop, and I was witnessing to some of the mechanics there and so forth. And this guy came up to me and he said, "So, what religion are you?" I said, "I'm not." And he couldn't understand. He said, "Well, what denomination are you?" I said, "I'm not." I said, "I'm a Christian, Christ-like." Well, what religion are you associated with? I said, "Man, you don't get it, do you? I'm not religious, and I'm not denominational. I'm Christ-like. That means I have a relationship with the one that made me. You have a relationship with an association. See, my identity is not where I fellowship. My identity is who I fellowship. And if everybody would start having the identity of who they fellowship with, then the identity of where they fellowship would bring him glory and not the place where they go. Amen? Amen? James chapter 1. And because we are in the last days, the word says that there'll be perilous times. Men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, and we see that constantly. Those two major things, lovers of self and lovers of money. People go through great lengths for money and to promote self. He also said that many would fall from the faith, taking heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. And the reason why many will fall from the faith, taking heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, because they won't realize that their influence is unseen. they're still living in the kingdom of self as a believer and not making what's unseen to become seen. Is everybody okay? Well, I want you to know that Jesus is trying to get the body right now to a place and position to not only receive his coming, but to make way for his coming. He's trying to get his people to make way. The Bible tells us that in the book of Malachi, that Elijah will come. In other words, that spirit will come. John the Baptist was in the spirit of Elijah, right? And then Jesus showed up. It's what's happening right now. It's a repeat. And what did he do? Man, he did a lot of great things. He called fire down from, come on. He took powers of darkness. He exposed them. He did all kinds of stuff, didn't he? He raised the dead. Why? Because he was in the anointing. It was the anointing. He walked in the anointing in preparation before the return of the anointed one. And that's what God's trying to get us. So I'm going to tell you right now, there was something that he shared with me, and he said, I am challenging my people. I'm challenging my people, and the purpose of challenging my people is to get them prepared. I'm going to challenge them to go deeper. I'm going to challenge them to let go of the traditions. I'm going to challenge them. And those who are not willing to be challenged will miss. They will miss what God is trying to do, and they will not be led by the Spirit. They'll have to be led by people who accepted the challenge. Amen. In James chapter 1, in verse 12, would you read it with me, please? Blessed is the man who what? Endures temptation, for when he has been what? Approved. Blessed is the man who endures temptation. Well, isn't temptation a challenge? Amen. Does God know you're being tempted? Does he know you're being challenged? Does the devil challenge you every day? Yeah. Amen. Man, if you could unzip the natural realm into the spirit realm, you'd see demons coming up to you all the time, shooting off their mouths, spitting on you, and all kinds of stuff, trying to cause you to stumble. Blessed is the man who endures the challenge and the temptations, for when he's been approved, then he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Why do they? Because, see, you've got to, listen, love is not an area of, hi, I love you, and go do what you want to do. Love follows, love obeys, love trusts, love. There's a lot of people say, I love God. Let me have that joint. Man, I love God. Let me have that. Man, I love God. Look at that woman. That ain't loving God, man. It's loving yourself. Hello? That's the kingdom of self. See, the kingdom of self is actually the Matrix. They did a movie on it. Hallelujah. Let no one say that when he is tempted, I'm tempted by God. God doesn't tempt you. The devil does. I can't believe God allowed this to happen to me. He didn't. You did. Why? Because you listened to the voice of the stranger. You opened the door. You touched and agreed with something that was darkness. Bam, it came in, blinded you, and took you out. Boom. Hello? Man, I go to jail all the time. And when I go into the jail, I see some of the same guys coming in. And I tell them, oh, you're coming to fulfill your timeshare. I said, welcome home. Man, I don't like this. But wait, I said, you love home. You love this place. I don't love this place. Well, if you didn't, you'd do something about it. See, going to jail is a challenge to change. Hello? And that's what God is doing now. Challenging to change. You and I are being challenged to change. And if we're not willing to change, the limitations will stay. Why? Because he knows what's coming, and he's preparing for me and you to overcome what's coming. If we're not willing to be changed, we won't overcome. We'll be overcome. Hallelujah. But each one is tempted, hello, when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Where did that desire come from? Come on. Who do we fight? Powers of darkness. That desire was brought forth by the enemy. And when you agreed with it, oh. See, when the word says two touch and agree, it comes to pass. Even the devil knows the word of God and tries to get the word of God to work on his behalf instead of God's. So when somebody is tempted, they're drawn away by desires. You can't just be tempted without first being spoken to. You must be spoken to first. Why? Where did that desire come from? Well, I just thought of it. Well, you know, where'd that thought come from? Well, a voice. Where'd that voice come from? A presence. Where'd that presence come from? A demon. Disembodied spirit trying to access you because it needs to get fed. It says that when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. In other words, then we allow the presence of evil, because sin is the presence of evil. Then we transgress with it. When it comes full grown, it brings forth death, because the wages of sin is death. Amen? So we are blessed after resisting temptation and approved for blessing, challenged by the enemy. And God rewards you for the challenge in overcoming it. He always rewards us. In 1 Peter chapter 1, say, I'm challenged to change. 1 Peter 1. Remember something and come out of the kingdom of self where religion has been preached. Jesus is not religious. Sheesh. I don't know how to express that. We need to put neon signs on our mobiles. Jesus is not religious. You don't need to be religious if you're the creator. He's God. And he has a kingdom. He's a king of it. And he has a military. How many of y'all in his military? So that means that there's a military operation going on. Jesus is the chief and commander of the military. You and I have been sent into this realm not to become religious, but to fulfill a military operation. We are on a mission. Amen? See, so when you and I were, when we were sent into this realm, because we came from the presence of God, the moment we were conceived, we lost all memory and all inheritance. That's why we've always been looking, who am I, where am I here, where am I going? And we're looking for fulfillment because where you and I came from, we were fulfilled. So the enemy loves to put deception. Here's a bottle of false counterfeit fulfillment. Here's drugs of false fulfillment. Here's sex with false fulfillment. All of these things are false fulfillment. They're temporary. Why? Because we're actually looking for God's presence. Because that's where we came from. That's why the word says, forsake not to assemble. Because in corporate worship is the greatest presence of God. It's the greatest presence of God. And those who keep resisting corporate worship are resisting the challenge of God. And there'll be limitations established, placed upon them that they will never break because it only can be broke in corporate worship. That's where the anointing's at. Is everybody okay? In 1 Peter chapter 1. Oh, hallelujah. In verse 6, let's read it together. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by what? What's a trial? It's a challenge. That the what? Genuineness of your what? Your faith. Now, the word says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if you don't read the word of God, you got no faith. None. Oh, I love the Lord. I'm saved. Do you read his word? No. You got zero faith-o. And you can't be trusted because you'd be easily moved by your emotions and how you feel instead of truth. Verse 7, that the genuineness of your faith be much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you did not see him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressibly and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Genuineness of faith. You know, faith is also trust, isn't it? Trust in Christ. Many try to change their circumstances when Christ is trying to use his circumstances to cause us to change. Does everybody understand that? See, many people take more time trying to change the circumstance instead of allowing God to change me and you. Those are challenges that he brings across our life. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, one of the things he wants us to do is be genuine, real. Not pretending to be someone we're not. Second Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 16. Is everybody there? Is everybody okay? Let's speak it together. Therefore, we do not what? Lose heart, even though our outward man is what? Is what? Perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a what? Moment is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we don't look at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are what? Eternal. So it's working for us an eternal purpose. In other words, one of the things God is trying to do is get his will and his purpose into me and you. Will plus purpose equals destiny. Will plus purpose equals destiny. But if you're not willing to accept the challenge, you're not willing to change. Again, most people try to change the circumstances instead of allowing God to change us. That's why people jump from church to church, from relationship to relationship, because they're trying to change. See, I did the same thing when I was out there using dope. You know why they call it dope? Because you get real stupid. So I was pretty stupid. So I tried to change the dope, but it was still dope. Still made me stupid. I tried to change relationships. I tried to change locations. I tried to change my circumstances in hope that I would change by the circumstances. But no. I had to get to a place where I realized my circumstances are not going to affect me. They're not going to change me. They're going to challenge me to be changed. Amen? Amen? They're going to challenge me to be changed. So whatever you're going through, a trial, an affliction, testing, whatever, what's God trying to do? He's trying to challenge me and you to want to change. We've got to change and be prepared. You can't not fit something that is square into a round cylinder. It doesn't work. No matter how much you beat it, it doesn't fit. So you must go to the one that made that square and turn it into a round so it fits in the cylinder. So that means there's cooperation needed. Amen? Without cooperation, there is no change. And without cooperation, what happens is then more limitations begin to get placed on our life. We want to change, we want to do things, but we can't. Because we're still trying to do it according to the ways of the kingdom of self and not according to the ways of the kingdom of God. Is everybody okay? 1 Corinthians 13. If everybody would start looking at their circumstances and say, okay, Lord, what are you trying to show me? Instead of blaming everyone else. Lord, I can't believe this. I can't believe this. I can't believe this. Lord, why don't they listen to me? Why don't they do this? Why don't they do that? Why don't you shut up? And start looking at yourself. Who's in your mirror, homie? Amen? Amen. Start looking in your eyes and start finding one blinking at you. Yo. Hallelujah. Verse 11. 1 Corinthians 13, 11. Let's speak it. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. That's what God is trying to do us. He's trying to get us to put away childish things. Why? Because child still reacts. It's all a child's first words is, me. Me, 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 me. I. Mine, mine, mine. You put two kids in a small room, they're fighting over what's theirs, and they don't even own either one of them. We bought them all. What are you fighting over that toy for? It's mine. What do you mean? I'm the one that bought it. Does everybody understand? It's all about me, me, and me. In verse 11, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. What's he trying to do? Listen, you cannot grow without challenges. You stay the same. How do you think we change? We're always being challenged. What's God trying to do? Get us into a deeper place. He's trying to get us to a place of more maturity. Why? So people can see him in you and no longer you or me. I love this. Verse 12. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am known. And now abide faith, hope, love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. Listen, right now it is a time to see deeper, hear deeper, and go deeper. When a storm comes, you don't try to fight it face on. You know what you do? Duck. Hello, when somebody's swinging a baseball bat, you don't try to stop it with your head. You duck. In a storm, you let the storm fly over. Why? Because everybody who's doped up gets hit by the storm. If they haven't received information or the warning because they're dull of hearing or hard-hearted, they get hit by the storm. When God was saying, duck. And then when the storm rises by, flows by, get up. See, those are the ones that go rescue those who've been hit by the storm. It's amazing to me and why people will go in the worst parts of the country where tornadoes are and buy a mobile home. I don't get it. Why do you want to buy a mobile home in Tornado Valley? Hoping the hurricane straps hold it down? No. I mean, if you ever seen when tornadoes and hurricanes hit, what's the most damage? Mobile homes. Amen. Now listen, there's nothing wrong buying a mobile home in the safe place. But don't go buy a mobile home in a place of Hurricane Valley. You know what I'm saying? That's just plumb dumb. And it doesn't make any sense. Move then. Get out of there. Amen? Is everybody okay? Well, that's what God's trying to do. Get us out of the hurricane storms that are coming and prepare us. He's trying to get us to go in a deeper arena that we may know him, behold his glory, hear him better, see better, and be prepared. Breaking off the limitations of deception. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Again, I want to express, this is not a religious thing. This isn't religion. This is not about who's who in the kingdom. It's not nothing to do with positions, offices. This is about a personal walk with the one that made you. This is what this is about. We got enough puffy leaders. Amen. We need to arm our people. We need to start telling people what's getting ready to happen. Yes, put your trust in the Lord. Amen. What do you do after that? You learn what he's got for you. I see somebody drowning. I'm trusting in the Lord. Well, you're going to drown, bro. Why? Because he told you to bring a raft and you didn't listen. Hello. 1 Corinthians 9:19. Let's read it. Look at Paul says. He said, for though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all that I might what? Win more. What was he saying? See, Paul was willing to accept the challenges to change. In every preparation, every military operation, God has to prepare me and you for it. Even in the military, when they went out to Desert Storm or the SEALs went out, they all had to prepare. They had to know the plan. Everything had to be perfect timing. Does everybody understand? And that's what God prepares us for every attack of the enemy. He prepares us. If we're not listening, we get taken out. We get delayed. We get limitations put on us. For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win the more. Verse 20, look at this. And to the Jews I became a what? Jew, that I might win Jews. And to those who are under the law, as what? Under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. See, Paul didn't allow the circumstances to mislead him. He allowed God to change him so he could enter the circumstance and rescue people. To those who are without law as without law, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. Verse 22, read it with me. And to the weak I became as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. That's why God is going to, he challenges us. Once you learn how to be challenged, it's no longer a challenge. It becomes an unction. I'm going to say that again. Once you learn about the challenge, see, God has to challenge individuals that are not willing to be changed. Once the challenge is accepted and we learn the challenge, it becomes an unction. So we're no longer bucking or trying to change the circumstances. We get many people that come to our discipleship house and they try to change the discipleship house because they're not willing to change. Man, don't you think you ought to do this? Don't you think you ought to do that? Don't this, this, and this. Oh, shut up. Be quiet and change. Fit into what's going working. Hello. If you fit into what's working, you'll be an extension of the working change. Other than that, you'll stay the same. And that's where religion comes in. Religion doesn't want to change. It wants everything else to change around them. Hello. Praise God. Is everybody okay? Are you getting this? So in this, we've got to look at something very, very powerful. Because he wants to bring us to that place where it's no longer we that live, but him that lives. Amen? Okay. Become many things. Yes. James chapter 1. James chapter 1. Now, there's a place where God says, listen, you can't give what you don't have. It's like people trying to go into the jail and tell them what it's like to be in jail when they've never been there. It's like people trying to tell somebody how it is to be an addict when they haven't been an addict. Or what it's like to lose your family and lose everything and be homeless. Listen, you can't give what you don't have. Amen? So one of the things God is trying to do is get us to that place where we have everything from him to give. I can't tell someone about casting out devils if I never cast out one. I can't tell somebody about having devils if I didn't have any. Amen? I can't tell someone about what true freedom is unless I have it. I've experienced it. I can't tell someone about what the difference between a religion is and the deceptions of it unless I've been there myself. Again, we need to erase the word religion from our living. We are not religious. We are free because of Christ that paid the price. Christ is not religious. He's the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty. That's what Christ is, coming to this natural realm to bring freedom to those who are willing to step in his presence and learn how to fight with his presence. In James 1, verse 2, it says what? My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials or challenges. Count it joy. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience, people would stop grumbling and complaining if they realized that God was trying to get him to change, to become something in preparation for what's coming. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. He doesn't want me and you to lack anything. He's got it all for us. Amen? Challenge to change. And, you know, you can't change the challenge. You got to change. Because when you're not willing to change, it brings lack. Does everybody understand that? When you're not willing to change, it brings lack. In Hosea 4:6. I think this is probably my favorite scripture. Of course, one of them anyways. Hosea. Hosea 4:6, is everybody there? Let's speak it together, okay? Hosea 4:6. He says what? My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. That word knowledge is also understanding. They're destroyed for that. And because you've rejected my knowledge of understanding, I'll reject you from being a priest for me. That means someone who's close. And because you have forgotten the law of your God, I will forget your children. That's where the curse comes on the family line, because our forefathers or parents didn't do the right things with God. Does everybody understand that? That's an ancestral curse. That's where Daniel was praying and asking for repentance for the forefathers. Why? Because they were in captivity for 70 years. And he found the book of Jeremiah and said, you're supposed to be released now. And Daniel went to the father and said, what's up? Lord, why aren't we released yet? And he said, because no one's repented for the sins of the forefathers. Listen, I became an addict because I inherited it. because nobody ever broke it off of my life, because my parents were religious and ignorant of the truth of the unseen realm. They didn't know how to bind, loose, or cast down devils. They didn't know how to lay hands on the sick. They didn't know what the truth was. Oh, they went to church, but they didn't even know what the anointing was. They didn't know. And because their parents didn't know, and because their parents didn't know, so when I had my visitation from the Lord, I realized, man, I've been lied to my whole life, even by my own parents. Not that they did it on purpose. They just passed on a lie. And I became an addict because nobody knew how to break it off me. But I got a visitation from the one who made me. And he said, son, they might have forgotten you and forsaked you, but I didn't. Come on, I'll show you. Next thing I know, a serpent comes out of my body.
Whoa.
Manifest in the physical realm. I began to see demonic forces and all kinds of stuff. Got introduced to the Holy Spirit, who began to teach me, bring me to the throne room of God, show me the word, tell me things to come, prepare me. Was willing to accept any challenge. Every challenge that came across my path, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Challenged me to read because I couldn't read. I was a no reader. The only thing I could read was the numbers on the flashcards and booking, you know, spreadsheets, stuff like that. My people are destroyed for lack of understanding, and what God is doing right now, because we need to have the understanding, we are being challenged to get a prophetic understanding of time and season and what's going on right now. People are still in delusion. In Matthew 15, in verse 1, then the scribes and Pharisees who were from Jerusalem came to Jesus trying to challenge him. He said, why do your disciples transgress your traditions of the elders because we're so religious? He said, for they do not wash their hands when they eat bread. And Jesus answers them, why do you also transgress the commandment of God because of your tradition? Now, the commandment of God was deny yourself, pick up the cross, and follow. For God commanded, saying, honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father and mother, let him be put to death. But you say, whoever says to his father or mother, whatever profit you might have received from me is a gift to God, then he did not honor his father or mother. Thus you have made the commandment of God of no effect by your traditions. He said, hypocrites. Well, Isaiah did prophesy about you, saying, these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And in vain they worship me, teaching as the doctrines of the commandments of men. And when he had called the multitude to himself, he said to them, hear and understand. Hear and understand. Stand. In Colossians chapter 2. What is the challenges in your life? What's God allowing to challenge? Is it associations? Is it giving up certain things? Is it seeking certain things, getting deeper? What's he trying to challenge you to become more like him? Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8, or verse 4. Let's speak it together, please. Now this I say, lest anyone should deceive you with persuasive words. Hallelujah. For though I am absent in flesh, yet I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As you have therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead body, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principalities and power. In him you are also circumcised with circumcision made not with hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith and working of God, who raised him from the dead. And you being dead in your trespasses and uncircumcision of your flesh, he made alive together with him, having forgiven you all the trespasses, having wiped away all the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So let no one judge you in food or drink or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbath, which are the shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Christ. Why? We're to be Christ-like. Even the word says, imitate him. Imitate him. And go to Revelation 3. Revelation chapter 3. We don't do Bible studies, we do training sessions. The Bible is the greatest training manual there is. Revelation 3:14. Is everybody there? Let's speak it together, please. And to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful, the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, that I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I could wish you were cold or hot. So then because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Hello. Are you lukewarm? Is this the challenge God's trying to bring to you to get hot, to get on fire, to get filled, to become thirsty and hungry for his presence? And to know him. Verse 17, because you say I'm rich and have become wealthy, and I have a job and I have clothes and an overhead, I have a car and I have all these wonderful things. And do not know that you are wretched, miserable, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in fire, that you may be rich in white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. Why? Because deception brings blindness. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, and therefore be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into him and dine with him and be with him. And to him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. Lukewarm. That's an individual that's not willing to change. He will stay lukewarm. Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12. Everybody has to go through the change. We change from glory to glory. We must be willing to change. And there is a challenge to change. Things that are happening in our life right now, today, every one of us is being challenged to change. In Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 3, for consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as sons and daughters. My child, my son, my daughter, don't despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you're rebuked. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and corrects. He scourges every child and son whom he receives. For if you are you endure the chastening, you're willing to change, you're willing to cooperate, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons, because these challenges are what caused me and you to change. We want to change. Furthermore, we've had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chasten us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Why? See, the world knows good and evil. They do not understand righteousness. Righteousness can only come from eating from the tree of life. Good and evil comes from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's why many people go, well, I'm a good person. I don't mean any harm to this. See, they're still looking at them being good instead of him being righteous. They're still living in the kingdom of self. And you don't want to die in the kingdom of self. Hebrews 3. In verse 7. Amen. Is everybody there? Let's read it. Therefore, the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, today, if you'll hear his voice, today, if you'll hear his voice, today, if you'll hear his voice, look, it's the Holy Spirit that's speaking to us today, not this person. It's the anointing that teaches, not a person. Today, if you'll hear his voice, do not harden your heart as in the rebellion. In the day of trial in the wilderness where your fathers tested me, tried me, and saw my works 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart, and they have not known my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Verse 12, beware, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any one of you should be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For if we become partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the end, while it said today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in rebellion. See, one of the things is childlike, we have a tendency to run because we're not willing to accept the challenge and change. So we want to run. We want to find something easier. Doesn't a child always look for something easier? Amen. That's childish. That's immaturity. Amen. Does everybody get this? God is trying to grow us up. I don't care how long you've been a believer. I don't care how many things you've done in the past. What are you doing now? What's happening right now in your life and your challenge right now? Are you running or are you willing to change? I'm going to close at 1 Peter 5. First Peter 5, verse 6. Therefore, humble yourself. That means you got to deny yourself. You can't change. Why? Because God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself. Be willing to change. Repent for your grumbling and complaining. Repent. Therefore, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you in due time, and stop exalting yourself. Casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. It says, be sober. That means alert. Be vigilant. That means consistent. Why? Because you can't change without being consistent. Be alert, be consistent, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Well, how is he going to devour? He devours those who are not willing to change. Why? Because God changes us to make a way of escape. And individuals that are not willing to change get caught up. Limitations, lack, all kinds of things. Bondage, false, counterfeit presences of God. Verse 9, it says what? Resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. And may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. Now look at this. This is wonderful. He said, after you suffered a while, after you've been challenged, after you suffered a while, hopefully you're going to want to change. After you suffered a while and you've gone through dragging, let me tell you, you're either going to, God's going to show you how to jump over the bush, or you're going to get dragged through it. And it's usually a pricker bush. After you've suffered a while, he's going to perfect you because you're willing to change. He's going to perfect you. He's going to establish you. He's going to strengthen you. Then he's going to settle you so you're immovable. So that you're not moved anymore by how you feel, what you think, and sometimes what you believe. Because many people have a flawed perception because they got a flawed belief system. So he's going to strengthen us. He's going to perfect us. He's going to establish us. And he's going to settle us after we're willing to be challenged to change. Are you willing today? If you're willing to be challenged and changed and cooperate with it, stand up. Lift your hands to heaven. This is vital today, I'm telling you. Everyone repeat after me, Holy Father, I'm willing. Forgive me. I commit it to you. My life, my will, my desires, my thoughts, my heart, my life. I'm nothing without you. I accept the challenge today. Show me what I must do to change, that I may be more like you. Settled and perfected and unmovable. In Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.